participating in what I would call a very robust discussion about climate change and the economy and what to do about it that's occurring really at every possible level of our society right now, from the very local, from the individual, up through the regional and state level, and very quickly right on up to the international level. It's a kind of an exciting time to be thinking about these things, but it's let me admit that for me in particular, it's very difficult to follow what's going on, and it must be even more difficult if you haven't had a lot of training, are not familiar with the lingo, and don't have a lot of time to spend on this. So what I'm going to do tonight is try to tee up, really, five ideas that I think are important and perhaps underappreciated, and I'll talk a little bit more about them tomorrow. But all they really do is raise questions and hopefully provoke you and all of us, really, to think more about this problem. So the first idea is about something that I think tends to get lost in the larger discussion, and it really is the focus, or one of the ways of thinking about the focus of this event. And to an economist, the way we phrase it is, well, what's the cost of doing nothing? What if we just do nothing? Does that mean nothing's going to happen? Well, the answer is probably the cost of doing nothing is likely to be very high in dollar terms. One of the most famous estimates of this cost was by Lord Stern, who put out the so-called Stern Review, and he calculated that between 5% and 20% of global economic output, which translates to $3 to $12 trillion per year, was at risk from climate change. Just this week, and I'm afraid to say it hasn't been peer-reviewed, so we have to take this with a lot of salt, grains of salt. An economist and an ecologist and a social scientist teamed up to produce a dollar estimate of what we may be losing from the cooling services provided by reflective ice, reflective snow, and stored methane in the Arctic ecosystem. And they came up with some pretty big numbers, between $60 and $371 billion this year, with that amount likely to rise over time. My colleague Pete Larson at the Institute of Social and Economic Research 3 years ago did a very careful analysis of how much we might have to pay to keep our public infrastructure up and running in Alaska. And he came up with numbers in the range of $10 to $20 billion over the next 50 years to compensate for what climate change could do through changes in permafrost, increased coastal erosion, and other impacts like that just on our infrastructure. And finally, a number that Jeremy has, he alluded to the fact that very little economic analysis has been done of the potential effects of acidification. And it is very difficult to try to estimate these impacts right now because we know so little about the linkages between CO2, pH, and on through the food web to the species that are of great commercial importance. But I think it's very, very fair to say that the cost of doing nothing is not zero. And this is something that is, you guys are a sophisticated audience, but I think you'd be surprised how often this gets lost in the debate. Second idea that's, I think, lost in the conversation a lot is that we really are all in this together. A kilogram of CO2 emitted here has the same effect on the global climate system as a kilogram of CO2 emitted in Beijing, China. It doesn't really matter. You can't really accuse someone else of emitting something that's any different from what we're emitting. And indeed, because of the very long residence time of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, today's warming, and in fact tomorrow's warming and the next decade's warming, is really going to be caused by emissions that you and I and our parents, for that matter, have already put into the atmosphere. There's a very long lag time in the system, so what we did yesterday is going to affect what other people have to deal with tomorrow. So we're really all in this together, both in space and in time. Idea three, we've got to put a price on carbon if we want to do something about this problem. And don't be fooled by all the different lingo about cap and trade, cap and tax, cap and dividend, carbon taxes, safety valves, hybrid plans. They're really all attempts, some I would argue more effective than others, to put some kind of a price on carbon. Now, sometimes this can be explicit with a tax. We sort of agree to put a price on carbon, and we agree on what it's going to be. If we do cap and trade in an honest way, we end up with a price for carbon, but it gets set in the marketplace when people go to trade emissions allowances. I can explain more about that tomorrow. Don't have time to do it tonight. Just trust me. A price emerges in a well-functioning cap and trade scheme, and it's very similar to a tax. We can go for direct regulation, in which we end up with many different prices depending on what some regulator says I can and can't do. Or we could go for complete control of the economy, where we have a dictatorial control not only over what I can and can't do, but how much of it, and the penalties get pretty draconian, and now we're sort of back into the regime of the Soviet Union. And I would argue, if I had more time, that a straight-out carbon tax is the best way to put this price on carbon. Having said that, a corollary to this idea is that putting a price on carbon is really the best thing we can do right now to move on and attack this problem. Because the problem's not going to go away. All that science that we just heard about is not going to go away if we put our heads under the rug, as it were, and say, you know, tax, no way. No price, no way. Or think we can somehow avoid confronting the issue that we have to make carbon something that we have an incentive to emit less of. And that's what a price gives us. First of all, we could take the revenues from a carbon tax, and in fact there are bills that I think Alan can tell you about that propose to do this. We could take the revenue that we collect from ourselves as an incentive to emit less carbon, turn right around and give it back to ourselves to do what we want in other parts of the economy, to do low carbon but fun things. That's the so-called cap and dividend approach. A price, any kind of price, but the more explicit the better, also breaks what I would argue is an existing logjam of a whole bunch of investors lined up with billions of dollars and lots of great ideas. They're just waiting for the certainty to plunge ahead with massive investments in green energy technologies, with existing technology. Now, it's kind of shocking that despite all the uncertainty, U.S. wind capacity was up 39% in 2009. In the middle of a deep recession and great fiscal turmoil, financial turmoil. But over on the other side of the world, China has been going way faster than us. They've doubled their wind capacity every year. Double, 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 double. 5 years, that's 32 time greater than it was. A price helps us make a lot of decisions about how we're going to rearrange our lives and our economy without a lot of worrying. We don't have to calculate our personal carbon footprint every morning and argue with our spouse about how we're going to reduce it. We can let the price of gasoline help us do that. And finally, and most important, a price on carbon will stimulate new ideas, new innovation, and things that we haven't even thought of. And in the long run, not only does that solve the carbon problem, in the long run, innovation is what gives us economic progress overall. I'm going to skip to my last 2 points, because I am over my time. One point is very simple to make, As you think about adaptation in Alaska, I urge you to think about the problem of adapting to higher energy prices. Some people say, well, that's mitigation, that's not adaptation. But I think this is adaptation. It's an adaptation problem. If we can't solve this problem, all of our attempts to mitigate and be part of the solution are going to fall flat because people are going to be screaming about how they can't pay their heating bill. It affects all of our industries and all of our people. This is what Alan's going to talk about. I'll page through it to my final point. Final point is that there's a critical role that I think gets lost in between the role of the individual, which we hear a lot about and people think a lot about, and the role of the feds and the international system. And that is there's a crucial role for local and regional governments who, if you sit right down and look at what they actually do, they're the ones who are doing the nuts and bolts, long-range, sort of preventive and forward-looking planning and building and regulating that is going to determine over the next 50 to 100 years how effectively we can adapt to changing conditions like climate change. Thank you.